At the end of 44 BC, Marcus Tullius Cicero commenced to unleash his oratorical attacks against Marcus Antonius in the form of 14 Philippic speeches. However, the second of these 14 speeches never made it to the floor of the Roman Senate. Cicero's first Philippic speech had so enraged Marcus Antonius that Cicero's friends advised him not even to attend the following meeting of the Senate, lest Antonius arrange for his immediate execution. Cicero trusted in the advice of his friends and did not deliver his oration before the Senate, nor did he deliver it from the forum's rostra. Instead, Cicero sent a copy of his declamation to a then-exiled Marcus Junius Brutus in Athens, not knowing that Brutus would later give voice to the eloquent indictment of Antonius by duplicating and distributing the speech following the brutal slaying of Cicero. This speech that survived his execution bore Cicero's accusation that Marcus Antonius posed an even greater threat to the Roman Republic than had Lucius Sergius Catilina and Publius Clodius Pulcher, an opinion which accompanied the revelation that Marcus Antonius had been invited by Gaius Trebonius to take part in an earlier plot to kill Julius Caesar, which was already taking shape towards the end of the 45 BC year. And although this initial plot did not come to fruition, the startling disclosure that Antonius had concealed foreknowledge of a plan to murder the Roman dictator was enough to cast doubt on the character of Marcus Antonius, especially in light of the fact that he had been conveniently outside the Curia on the Ides of March in 44 BC, when Julius Caesar was assassinated, and had been curiously engaged in conversation with Gaius Trebonius. And now, for Caesar Divi Filius, having formally removed Rome's Pontifex Maximus, Marcus Aemilius Lepidus, from the second triumvirate, only the triumvir Marcus Antonius still stood in the way of absolute power falling into his hands. To this end, and amidst other allegations against Antonius, it is possible that Caesar covertly helped circulate the knowledge gained from Cicero's second Philippic speech. If it were widely believed that Antonius had entertained joining a conspiracy to kill Julius Caesar, such a defamation could effectively bring into question every action taken by Marcus Antonius in the aftermath of the dictator's murder. Following his 36 BC invasion of Media Atropatene, which ended in abject failure, Marcus Antonius nevertheless notified the Roman Senate of a victory against Rome's enemy Parthia. But, bearing further evidence to the contrary, were the letters from Antonius's legions, written to friends and loved ones, which told a different story than the official version, giving rise to widespread rumors. The scuttlebutt was that Marcus Antonius had waited too long in the year to begin the invasion of Parthia, and had irresponsibly allowed his baggage train to fall into Parthia's hands. But even more damning was the consensus that he was personally responsible for the loss of approximately 40% of his legions as the result of ongoing guerrilla attacks led by Parthian cataphracts, from succumbing to starvation, or having been unprepared to withstand exposure to the winter elements during their hasty retreat through the mountains of Armenia. Amidst whispers of frostbitten toes and ears, which required amputation in order to stave off gangrene, the Roman Senate summoned Marcus Antonius from the east several times, wishing him to appear before them to defend himself against the rumors. Ignoring these summons, Antonius remained in Alexandria, claiming that he was busy punishing King Artavasdes of Armenia for having abandoned him at Phrae Arta, and simply had no time to return to Rome as he was diligently occupied with planning yet another military campaign, which was to be funded by Egypt's Queen Cleopatra. Caesar Divi Filius, having taken Livia Drusilla as his third wife, in the hopes that marriage to the patrician Claudian would woo Rome's old conservative families, now sided with the Senate. Caesar Divi Filius was adamant that Marcus Antonius had much for which to answer. Relying on the oratorical brilliance of his ally, Gaius Maecenas, Caesar made sure that the actions of Marcus Antonius were recounted with enough political spin to insinuate that the Roman general was in the process of unraveling his quintessential Roman-ness in favor of an Eastern persona. Rewinding history back to the moment the Caesarians had defeated the liberators at the battles of Philippi, Marcus Antonius could now be portrayed as fundamentally out of control. while touring Anatolia, so as to right the wrongs perpetrated against it by Brutus and Cassius. Antonius had begun associating himself with the god Dionysus and had allowed himself to conform to the idol worship of Eastern peoples. Antonius had then scandalized the entire Mediterranean when he had ordered the brutal execution of the Ptolemaic princess Arsinoe IV, who had been exiled to the great temple of Ephesus, and had shocked the Roman world yet again when he had arranged the execution of Ptolemy XIII, a man claiming to be the rightful king of Egypt, who had allegedly taken refuge in Arcadia. Yet Caesar's artful orator, Maecenas, through literary sleight of hand, laid the blame at the feet of Cleopatra, whom Caesar Divi Filius accused of cuckolding his father, the late dictator Julius Caesar, with an illegitimate son she had actually conceived by a slave, so that she might lay claim to all of Rome. Caesar's narrative also maintained that Cleopatra had manipulated Marcus Antonius into securing her throne, an insinuation which reflected negatively on Antonius by portraying him as a man easily controlled by women. As if the Roman people needed further proof that Antonius was the plaything of politically ambitious women, they had only to recall that his late wife, Fulvia Flacca Bambula, had donned armor before leading forces against the capital, all while Antonius basked in the bosom of Cleopatra in the city of Alexandria. But after the jolt of Fulvia's Perugian War, Marcus Antonius seemed to come to his senses. Abandoning Alexandria and the twin children he had fathered with Cleopatra, Antonius returned to Italy after Fulvia's death, where he married a properly Roman matron, Caesar's sister, Octavia Thurina, by whom he fathered two more daughters named Antonia. Yet Antonius was still under Cleopatra's spell. Involving herself in Judean politics, Cleopatra cajoled the triumvir into securing the position of Judea's high priest for the son of her close friend, Alexandra Maccabeus. And also compliments of Marcus Antonius, Cleopatra was now in possession of the Roman territories of Cyrene, Crete, Cilicia, and the Levant, acquisitions which now joined the island of Cyprus, another Roman territory gifted to her by Julius Caesar. Not remarkably then, after leading his legions to the slaughter in Media Atropatene, Marcus Antonius had not gone home to Rome to seek the comfort of his Roman wife. Instead, Marcus Antonius rushed back to Alexandria, where he threw himself into the arms of his mistress, who had delivered yet another son for the Roman triumvir. These events concerned Caesar Divi Filius, whose fears multiplied as he watched Egypt claim one Roman territory after another. But of even more concern to him was Cleopatra's so-called son by Julius Caesar, and her portrayal of him as the fulfillment of her Egyptian religion in the person of Horus, an allegation which was made more substantial by the births of three additional Roman siblings fathered by Marcus Antonius, whose existence would help ensure eventual Roman acceptance of Cleopatra's son by Caesar. For Caesar Divi Filius, who felt that there can be only one Caesar, it was obvious that Cleopatra was the greatest threat to Rome and to his very own life. Yet, despite Caesar's discreet efforts to turn popular opinion against Marcus Antonius, his sister, Octavia Thurina, had a different plan. In the north of Italy, within the territory formerly known as Cisalpine Gaul, towns were under attack by raiding parties led by the Iapetes, tribes positioned inland from the coastal Liburni, which comprised the territories of what is today modern Bosnia and Herzegovina. The Iapetes raided the town of Aquileia, plundered the city of Trieste, and completely destroyed the coastal town of Pula. As Caesar prepared to take his legions north in order to deal with the Iapetes, his sister, Octavia, demanded her pick of 2,000 legionaries, which she would hand-deliver to her husband for his upcoming campaign against Armenia. Although it was not the 20,000 soldiers owed to Antonius by Caesar, it did represent Octavia's effort to demonstrate to her husband that he still had the support of his wife. Gathering up their combined children, Octavia then sailed from Italy, accompanied by a few transport ships carrying her husband's much-needed cargo. However, by the time she and the children reached Athens, Marcus Antonius, who had learned of his wife's intentions and journey, sent one of his generals with a note. When Octavia arrived at Antonius's mansion, she found the note, which contained orders from her husband. Octavia was to forward the 2,000 legionaries to him in Alexandria, but was to go no further herself. Antonius commanded Octavia and the children to remain in Athens. At this same time, for reasons which we do not yet understand, Antonius's eldest son Bifulvia, the 12-year-old Marcus Antonius Antillus, chose not to remain in Athens, but moved to Alexandria to live with his father and Cleopatra, and his three Egyptian half-siblings. Settling down in Athens, Octavia tended to all her children, which included Antonius's 7-year-old son Bifulvia, Iulus Antonius, whom she kept with her. In Italy, as Caesar's forces approached the town of Tarpanus, he sent ahead two groups of legionaries to stealthily man the cliffs along either side of the main road and to protect their passage forward. But the Iapetes were already awaiting the arrival of Roman legions and ambushed Caesar's forces as soon as they stumbled upon them. During the battle, the dispatched legionaries atop the cliffs descended on the melee, and the tide turned. The Iapetes were defeated. So that they would not be burned and plundered by his legions, Tarpanus surrendered to Caesar, who then placed a garrison of legions within the town. Advancing to Metulus, the main stronghold of the Iapetes, Caesar launched an immediate attack against the city, but was easily repelled by the more than 3,000 Iapetes who manned the city walls, thus forcing Caesar to lay siege to the city. As the Roman army continued battering the outer walls of Metulus, the citizens within the city were busy building new inner walls. When the outer walls finally crumbled, Caesar responded to the new walls by ordering his legions to build up mounds of earth. He then commanded several of his cohorts to go around the city and attack from the rear. Believing the Metulians' attention to be wholeheartedly drawn to the back of the town, Caesar ordered four bridges to be thrown down, connecting his earthen mounds to the tops of their inner walls. The Metulians, however, had not abandoned the front of the town and responded by attacking the bridges, destroying three of the four. Caesar, alongside Marcus Vipsanius Agrippa and several of his legates and bodyguards, crossed the fourth bridge at the front of their legions. However, this lone bridge was not strong enough to support the weight of so many people. The bridge collapsed, sending Caesar, Agrippa, and their entire party crashing to the ground, where Caesar sustained impact injuries to both his shoulder and his right leg. Despite being wounded, Caesar ordered his men to immediately construct more bridges. When the Metulians saw the determination of the Roman legions, they sent envoys out to Caesar. In exchange for not destroying Metulus, they promised Caesar 50 hostages and the acceptance of a Roman garrison within the city walls. They even promised Caesar that the Romans could have the highest and choicest hills within the city, while they would make do with the lowest hills. Caesar accepted the offer. As he ordered a garrison to march into the city, the Metulians locked all their women and children within the city's council chamber, placing guards outside the doors. Once Caesar's garrison was inside the city, the Metulians launched an attack against them. When this attack failed and the Metulians were easily repelled by the Roman garrison, the guards posted outside the city's council chamber were commanded by the Metulians to set the building on fire. Many of the women grabbed their children and jumped into the inferno, while others killed their children first and then themselves, rather than burn alive. The fire from the council chamber spread until all of Metulus lay a smoldering ruins. Following the destruction of Metulus, the Iapetes formally surrendered, offering the required number of hostages to Rome as a guarantee of the Iapetes' continued compliance. Caesar next marched his forces towards the Segestani. This tribe had been twice defeated by the Romans, but because the victorious generals had never demanded hostages from them, the Segestani continued to rebel. Marching through Pannonia toward the town of Segesta, Caesar's column underwent constant guerrilla attacks aimed at stragglers who had allowed themselves to fall behind. To prevent their continued assaults, Caesar ordered the fields be burned between his forces and the town of Segesta, removing the Pannonians' ability to hide and ambush his forces. Arriving at Segesta, Caesar Divi Filius demanded the town provide hostages, that they accept a cohort of garrisoned legionaries, and that the city stockpile food for his forces. The town of Segesta grudgingly acquiesced to Caesar's demands. However, as the legionaries entered the town of Segesta, the Segestani closed and barred the gates and manned their walls. Once again, Caesar was forced to besiege a town. As the Romans began the organized process of investing the town, the Segestani got word out to the Pannonians that they needed help. When the Pannonian forces arrived to aid Segesta, they were staved off by Caesar's legions. Many of the Pannonians were killed, and the remainder were put to flight. Seeing the loss of their Pannonian relief army, Segesta formally surrendered to Caesar. The siege of Segesta had lasted 30 days. Caesar Divi Filius did not punish Segesta for its resistance by burning the city to the ground. Instead, he fined the town, demanded even more hostages, and increased the size of the garrison they must accept to 2 cohorts, or approximately 2.5 legions. Following the surrender of the Segestani, the rest of Pannonia followed suit. For the moment, Caesar had achieved an end to hostilities in Pannonia, leaving one of his legates, a man named Fufius Geminus, to govern the area. Caesar made his way back to Rome. With his success in Pannonia added to his victory against Sextus Pompeius, which brought an end to Italy's famine, Caesar's popularity continued to skyrocket, in direct contrast to the plummeting popularity of Marcus Antonius, spawned by propagation of rumors of the disaster in Media Atropatene. Riding this wave of adoration, Caesar decided to try for even more glory. Because of Julius Caesar's abrupt departure from Britannia in 54 BC, no administrators were left behind to protect the flimsy arrangements he had imposed on the Britannians. As a result, the island of Britannia had quietly retreated into the obscurity it had enjoyed prior to Caesar's conquest. But Caesar Divi Filius decided that now was an auspicious time to formally hold Britannia to his father's arrangements and bring her fully into the Roman fold. With plans to urbanize the island of Britannia, by force if necessary, Caesar Divi Filius, the chosen son of Britannia's divine conqueror, turned his legions north and set out for Gaul.